In the spirit of reconciliation, we acknowledge the Aboriginal, Torres Strait Islander and Maori people who are the traditional custodians of the land, seas and waterways of Australia and New Zealand. We honour their cultural heritages and pay our respects to elders, past and present. We also acknowledge the rich contribution our First Peoples make to our nations.
Thank you, Gwenda. Very appropriate coming from you from New Zealand as we acknowledge both of our cultures. Thanks, Bernadette.
Welcome to all of you who are joining us on this pilgrimage into the land of Lay Carmelites. Gabrielle and Antoinette graciously accepted the invitation to lead us, and they say, it is a pleasure to share our story of the early pilgrims into the Holy Land of Mount Carmel, some aspects of our charism and life in Carmel today. Whether you are a current member of the Lay Carmelites or are new to Carmel. So over to them.
Thank you, Bernadette. And I guess our introduction to everyone is in the form of our rule of the Third Order of Carmel. 20 years ago, the Lay Carmelites were given an updated version of our own rule. The rule of the Third Order of Carmel, referred to as the RTOC. It provides us with a formula for life in today's world, much the same as Albert or Saint Albert formulated a rule for the first Carmelites more than 800 years ago. Our rule helps us keep our eye on the goal, and we're going to use it today as it may give you some insights. Mary is going to be our proclaimer of the rule. So if we ask Mary, would you mind reading this for us?
Lay people are accompanied in their living of the Carmelite charism in spirit and in truth by valid spiritual guides and those consecrated in the religious life. They are open to the Holy Spirit's works and moving towards a full participation and communion in the Carmelite charism and spirituality. This will lead to a new charismatic interpretation of their lay nature and to a fully co-responsible share in the task of evangelization and in the ministry specific to Carmel.
RTOC 15 reaffirms to us in Carmel that this ancient path is for all. The Synod on Synodality, which has just finished in Rome, has had three main themes: participation, communion, and evangelization. And you will recognize these same words here. These words are being highlighted today for all in the church as the current synod steps through a path of renewal and reform. Today, our presentation will include the following topics. Walking the ancient path is something that Antoinette is going to lead, and Carmelites in Our Land, also by Antoinette. And then I will look at the call and the charism and living the Carmelite way. But before we continue, let's take a few moments to reflect on a song by Michael W. Smith, Ancient Words, Holy Words, Long Preserved for Our Walk in This World.
Long preserved for our walk Okay, so I'm doing some outline on our history of the Carmelite Order and the Australian Lay Carmelites, Australian New Zealand Lay Carmelites. And I should be able to do that, right?
Yes, thank you. Great.
Can everyone see the full screen?
Yes. No, that's okay. We're right to see.
You can see the full screen. Okay. So just to focus us in on what's the background. So basically, for those of us who are aware, some of us might not be that aware, Mount Carmel is here. It's a mountain range that faces the Mediterranean Sea. And it's actually from ancient times known to be a symbol of fertility and beauty, and Carmel means garden. So this is a very important place because this is where Elijah conquered the priests of Baal, testifying that God of Israel was the one true and only God. And it's important that we sort of put ourselves in that space because the Elijah and is considered as the first monk and the Carmel and the original Carmelite hermits followed the idea that this is where he had been. They weren't just they were walking in Jesus's footsteps, being on Mount Carmel, but they were also they were also sharing Elijah's spirit. Okay, so origins in the Holy Land. So we have the Third Crusade, and it's about 1189 to 1191. We have the pilgrims and maybe probably crusaders who've decided to stay in the Holy Land. There's not considered to be any ordained people who stay. They're just all lay people, and they decide to set up themselves in the naturally formed caves that exist in Mount Carmel near the springs of Elijah. So Elijah is seen as the order's spiritual father, and these people have just come together with their desire to live in the land where Jesus had walked in and to retreat from the world. So after that the time had passed, they decided to build a chapel with some individual cells around it. And at this time, it was traditional to dedicate a building to the Lady of the Manor. So they dedicated it to Our Lady, and she became our patroness. And they wanted to live in allegiance to Jesus Christ in the same way she had. And so eventually they became known as the Brothers of St. Mary of Mount Carmel. As time went on, the group wanted to have a way of life that to help them to focus their spirituality more. So they approached Albert of Elgado, who was the Patriarch of Jerusalem at the time, and he prepared a rule for them sometime between 1206 and 1214. And this document was steeped in scripture, and it had a wonderful human element to it that advised that common sense prevail at all times. Eventually, the hermits had to return to Europe because of the Saracens trying to take over the Holy Land, and they were actually making quite a lot of progress. So in 1235, they were forced to abandon their life on Carmel, return to Europe, and they established their largest centre in Britain at Aylesford. And from there, they spread their Carmelite spirituality to all over the British Isles and the rest of Europe. Pope Innocent IV modified Albert's text into an official religious rule in 1247, And so the Carmelite order joined the other mendicant orders, such as the Franciscans and the Dominicans, who served the laity by preaching and ministering to their needs in return for charity. They were beggars and they depended on the charity of the people and donations from some of the more wealthy people that were in the towns or where they were stationed. They now lived as communities of friars among the laity. So things had changed quite a bit. So the laity were very attracted to the spirituality of the various orders. We had the Dominicans, the Franciscans, the Augustines. There's quite a few different ones that established themselves. So Lay Carmelites actually officially begin when the orders try to respond to this desire that the laity have to embrace the spirituality of the various order and to live it in their secular lives. The orders responded with a movement known as the Third Order. In regards to the Carmelites, the Prior General Blessed John Soroth, he was able to establish the Second Order of the Enclosed Nuns, as well as the Carmelite Third Order for the laity. And this occurred in 1452 when Nicholas V passed the bull cum nulla. So we ended up being a bit late in regards to getting our Carmelites, but everything progressed and everything went forward from there. Okay, so we now have what happens in Australia. As most people know, because of the Protestant split with the Catholic Church, there was no way that Macquarie wanted to have any Catholic priests around. So we were very lucky that we ended up with two Lay Carmelites coming out to Botany Bay, James Dempsey and John Butler, and they were transported for life for their alleged involvement in the Irish Rebellion of 1798. So when they arrived in 1802, there was actually three prisoners among them, but three priest prisoners among them, but they were permitted to do very little. And they were all sent back to Ireland, despite whatever their jail term was, by 1810. So for the next 10 years, except for a few months in 1817 to 1818, about 6 months, there's no Catholic priest in Australia. So Dempsey was at the centre of Catholic life in the colony. He made his house a religious and social centre, and they had Sunday vespers. They recited those, and on weekdays, the rosary was prayed. Children were taught catechism, and they also sang in a little choir that was organised by two other members of the Catholic community. Dempsey would also accompany with prayers anyone who was condemned to hang. He'd walk them to the scaffold. The Carmelite charism made a world of difference to many. So at this point then, in 1817, Father O'Flynn arrives to the colony, but the Governor Macquarie gets him deported within 6 months. But whether it was intentional or not, I think it was intentional. He left the Blessed Sacrament in Dempsey's house. And once this was discovered, Dempsey organised the best room in his house to put the Blessed Sacrament in, and he turned it into a little chapel. They organised a confraternity of men, including John Butler, who would watch over the Blessed Sacrament. We finally have Catholic priests arrive in the colony. So we have Fathers Colony and Theory arrived in 1820, and pretty straight up, they wanted to build a church. This was going to be the first St. Mary's Cathedral, which actually burnt down in 1865. Dempsey was a stonemason, and so he was took on the position of superintendent of construction, and he was also a chief fundraiser. Now, from the start, they had big problems because Father Terry was very disorganised with his approach to the finances, and this created a lot of problems. So Dempsey struggled to keep the building going, and he put his own money into the church to keep the work proceeding. He also was absolutely appalled because the two priests had ended up in conflict, and he was trying to try to assist this. And he wrote to Father Terry to suggest that whoever humbled himself first would be the greatest among them. However, the conflict continued. The cathedral was actually finished, and according to the modern historian Waldersee, it would have never been completed without Dempsey's efforts. This is directly a result of his Carmelite spirituality and his commitment to the people in the colony. And he worked and did much more than any priest could have done in his circumstances, I would say. Carmelite priests arrived. So we finally get some priests, and it, which is wonderful. 1881 to 1902, Bishop Reynolds of Adelaide invites the Irish Carmelites to come out to Gawler in Adelaide, and five priests arrive, and they are organising a parish that was almost 700 square miles. Everywhere they went, and every place they went into, there were several parishes and other communities. They established the confraternity of Our Lady of Mount Carmel, which at that time was the equivalent of the Lay Carmelite concept. So 1902 to 1928, they get asked to go to Adelaide because the prior's quite worried about their state because they're running around. And he's worried about they're not being able to do their prayers properly, etc. 1909 to 1928, Middle Park and Port Melbourne are looked after. So this is really important because Middle Park and Port Melbourne are the basis of everything to do with the Lay Carmelites beginning. So more priests arrive, and an Australian novitiate was started in 1928, and Melbourne Lay Carmelite Community was the first to start in 1950. Okay.
Thank you. So moving on. Antoinette, are you going to introduce our Lay Carmelite Council members?
Yes. So we've got Margaret Stoll. Margaret, there you are, so I couldn't see. And Leonie Morrison, that are going to speak to us briefly about a question they've thought about and give you some information about their perception of being a Lay Carmelite.
Should I go first?
Thank you.
Yeah.
Because Margaret's still muted. So very honoured to be a Lay Carmelite, and I started going to the Warwick meetings, and I really believe that our life is supposed to be a life of prayer, and I believe that's what the Carmelites are, and what the Carmelites do is pray. And there is always so much to pray for, and I believe that the basis of our lives is prayer. And I'm very honoured to have been that I am now in the role as data coordinator and pastoral care for the Lay Carmelite Council. So thank you.
Thanks, Leanne.
I'm Margaret Stolke, and my journey as a Carmelite has been back from India, from Calcutta, where I always went to the Carmelite monastery and visited the nuns with my mother. So my Carmelite journey goes back to many, many years back in India. But I came to Melbourne and I was looking for the Carmelites, so I couldn't find them. But a friend introduced me to Damien and Irene, and I'm so blessed and honored to have met them, to start my spiritual journey with the Carmelites. And I met Teresa, and I got received into the Lay Carmelites in 2014. And I took my first profession in 2016, and thereafter my final profession. And I'm so honored to be part of the Melbourne Lay Carmelites, as well as the Lay Carmelite Council, the secretary for the council members. They're all beautiful people, as well as our Melbourne Lay Carmelites. I'm the treasurer there. So I love being part of this family. I enjoy it. Thank you very much.
God, beyond our dreams, you have stirred in us a memory. You have placed your powerful spirit in the hearts of humankind. All around us we have known you. All creation lives to hold you. In our living and our dying, we are bringing you to birth. God, beyond our names, you have made us in your image. We are like you, we reflect you, we are woman, we are man. All around us we have known you, all creation lives to hold you. In our living and our dying, we are bringing you to birth. God, beyond all words, all creation tells your story. You have shaken with our laughter, you have trembled with our tears.
We are all seekers searching for life's meaning. looking for the source or the mystery of life and our part in it. In asking the question, who are the Lay Carmelites? Today we are going to gently step through some of our rule for the Third Order. So let's start with Rule 20, which could really apply to all of us. And that word tertiary, I think, may have been mentioned. It is just another name for the Third Order. Thank you, Mary.
Thank you. Through the sacrament of baptism, which makes each person a member of the mystical body of Christ, tertiaries receive their call to holiness. So together with others, according to the call and gifts of each one, they can contribute to that great work of building up the one body of Christ.
All of us are called by our baptism, but for some, there is an insatiable desire to deepen that call. Very often occurring in midlife, but not always. We go on searching for the God beyond all names.
Some lay people have a particular call and vocation to participate in the charisms of religious families, which are a common patrimony of the people of God, and which become for them too a source of energy and a school for life.
We have heard the call of the ancient words as heard in our opening reflection song. Words of life, words of hope, give us strength, help us cope. Ancient words will guide us home. But from whom do lay Carmelites learn the way home to a Carmelite life? The primal source of developing our relationship with God and Jesus is Scripture. In the original rule of St. Albert, the hermit is encouraged to read, listen to, reflect on, or pray Scripture. It is from here we learn how to be guided by the spirit of Elijah, the family life of Jesus, and his mother, Mary.
Gradually, Jesus must become the most important person in the Lay Carmelites' existence. This means having a personal, warm, affectionate, and constant relationship with Jesus. This bond is nourished by the Eucharist, the liturgy in general, by Holy Scripture, and by various forms of prayer.
This unique path is shaped by time, tied to a long history of travellers to the present day, with its contemporary authors and scholars giving us a true direction to follow. One such author is Carmelite theologian Jack Walsh, OCARM, who has reflected our Carmelite tradition in one of his many books, which is used in our formation program. It's called The Carmelite Way, An Ancient Path for Today's Pilgrim. The future of Carmel upholds the past, shares its history, converts it into prayer and practice through the three pillars of our charism. Another most obvious source of developing the Carmelite way is by emulating the lives of prayer and witness of our Carmelite saints. And that's so appropriate today, isn't it, as we celebrate the feast day of All Saints. In particular, let us look briefly at our most revered saints of 500 years ago, Saint Teresa of Avila and Saint John of the Cross.
Lay Carmelites live a life of intense prayer, personal, communal, liturgical, and informal, focused on a personal dialogue with the Lord, the true friend of humanity. As Saint Teresa of Jesus says, prayer is nothing more than an intimate and frequent dialogue of friendship with the one who we know loves us. In prayer, the essence is not in much thinking, but in much loving. More than an exercise, it is an attitude which implies the recognition of God's hand, the openness to accept gratuitous love as gift.
So let's look at just a few points from our two saints of 500 years ago. Saint Teresa of Avila. Teresa believed that self-knowledge was essential for spiritual development. In the interior castle, Teresa says, the mystery at the centre of the castle first spoke us into life and continues to address us, calling us more deeply into our lives, into wider freedom and more intimate union. God is always already there in the centre of our existence. Prayer requires attentiveness, and initially efforts to pray may require great effort. Teresa herself struggled with just how one transitions from meditation to contemplation. John of the Cross leaves us a legacy of poetry and which serves as prayer and nourishment to people of many faiths and denominations. We don't own these saints. People who are Christian across the board just love what they write. John taught that contemplation was the key to freeing a heart enslaved by idols. At the core of his teaching is an acknowledgement that only God's love can break through the heart wrapped in attachments. Contemplation is simply opening one's life to this love. In John's experience, only that mysterious presence dwelling at the center of each one's life is sufficient food for the hungers of the heart. John imagined this mystery as a night, a flame, a lover. The soul center is God, he said.
In the family, in the workplace, in the professions, in social or church responsibilities, in the deeds of everyday life, and in relationships with others, Lay Carmelites look for hidden signs of God.
Two of our contemporary saints that support us on our spiritual journey are Saint Therese of Lisieux and Saint Titus Brandsma. There is so much written and electronic material available for you to explore all of these saints if you wish to delve deeper. Saint Therese is one of the greatest and most loved saints of modern times, her words echoing loudly in this month of October in Rome. During this latest synod of bishops in Rome, Pope Francis released a timely apostolic exhortation to mark the 150th anniversary of the birth of Saint Therese. Entitled Confidence in the Merciful Love of God, the exhortation encapsulates and affirms why Therese's little way of love and simplicity touches so many hearts. These points at the conclusion of the exhortation are valuable words to guide us, so we'll just mention a few of them. The very last chapter in the exhortation says, "From heaven to earth, the timely witness of Saint Therese of the Child Jesus and the Holy Face endures in all the grandeur of her little way." It goes on to say, "In an age that urges us to focus on ourselves and our own interest, Therese shows us the beauty of making our lives a gift. In an age that casts aside so many of our brothers and sisters, she teaches us the beauty of concern and responsibility for one another. At a time of great complexity, she can help us rediscover the importance of simplicity, the absolute primacy of love, trust, and abandonment, and thus move beyond a legalistic or moralistic mindset that would fill the Christian life with rules and regulations and cause the joy of the gospel to grow cold. In an age of indifference and self-absorption, Thérèse inspires us to be missionary disciples, captivated by the attractiveness of Jesus and the gospel. Time does not permit us to explore the lives of other contemporary and prophetic saints. But in these troubled times, there is one saint in particular we believe is truly a prophetic figure sent by God to guide us, especially in today's world. Titus Brandsma was canonized just 18 months ago in May 2022. He was steeped in the Carmelite tradition, teaching and writing about its spirituality. For 19 years, he had lectured at the Catholic University of Nijmegen in Holland, which he helped found. The positions he took on behalf of justice flowed naturally from his contemplative life. For this service in the midst of the people, Titus was martyred at Dachau on the 26th of July, 1942. Author John Walsh asserts, within the Carmelite family, the death of Titus Brandsma has been a recent reminder of the demonic loose in the world and the serious implications of living in allegiance to Jesus Christ. As we have heard, down the centuries, the Carmelite Order has offered the laity a share in its life and ministry. The lay members living in the world, married or single, strive under the direction of the Order to take its spirit into their everyday environment. They are called to be leaven in the world. It is the sharing of ideals that makes our Carmelite family. It is the give and take. It is the desire to make a commitment to the group. It is the will to share in the life and aspirations of the family that make it work. Carmelites pray with many forms, but essentially all forms are meant to open us to the mystery which haunts our lives. From this attentiveness flows identity, community, and service to the world.
The communal life of lay Carmelites must shine with simplicity and authenticity. Every group must be a family in which everyone feels at home, welcomed, known, appreciated, encouraged on the path they are following, and possibly even corrected with charity and kindness.
From the beginning of this tradition in Palestine, life with others has been an integral component of Carmelite spirituality. Time has only strengthened the value of living as a community. The witness of such a community can be one of the most powerful actions on behalf of a more just and peaceful world. In a world torn apart with divisions, people living peacefully together cannot be underestimated.
Like all Carmelites, the lay Carmelite is called to some form of service, which is an integral part of the charism given to the order by God. Since it is the proper calling of lay people to live in the world and in the midst of secular affairs, they are called upon by God to carry out this mission of the church so that there is a Christian yeast in the temporal activities which they are deeply engaged in. The faithful cannot renounce their participation in public life.
Teresa taught us that prayer and action go hand in hand. She knew that our inner and outer lives need each other. As she draws on the example of Martha and Mary walking together, we can see that so effortlessly in the service of God and of others. Today, the Carmelite Orders, following the Church teaching on social justice, have called their members to a preferential option for the poor. Living in the midst of the people, as Carmelite documents urge, will result in a new experience of the living God. Our Carmelite saints have demonstrated that the contemplative tradition is actually the deepest source of compassion for the world, giving concerns for social justice a prominent place in the Carmel way. But let's get down to the nitty-gritty. In practical terms, what is the formal process of becoming a lay Carmelite? There are two ways of becoming a lay Carmelite: as a member of a community or as a distance member, depending on your circumstances, but accompanied by a spiritual companion. Inquirers are encouraged to join in a day of reflection or retreat with the nearest community once a year. They would be invited to start a formation program with a community formator or a spiritual companion, undertaking to establish communication to enhance their program. After a period of around 12 months, if they feel God is calling them to this life of prayer, the inquirer will be invited to apply to be received in a simple ceremony to enfold them in the Carmelite family. Enrollment in the scapular is part of this ceremony. Following reception, a two-year program of formation in Carmelite spirituality prepares them to make a temporary commitment, that is, first profession. After 3 years of ongoing formation and continuing to attend to correspond with the formation companion, the candidate may consider and discuss their vocation to Carmel and possible final profession. Each of these steps will be accompanied by periods of discernment and will include written applications to the Lay Carmelite Council of Australia and New Zealand. That actually ends our formal presentation, but now we'd like to hear from you and a little bit of discussion.